Jeremiah 24, let me read just a preamble part, and then we'll just jump right in. In Jeremiah 24, the Lord showed me, Jeremiah, and there were two baskets of figs, and they were set before the temple of the Lord after Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away captive Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, and the princes of Judah with the craftsmen and the smiths from Jerusalem, and had brought them to Babylon. One basket had very good figs, like the figs that are first ripe, and the other basket had very bad figs, which could not be eaten. They were so bad. And then the Lord said to me, "What do you see, Jeremiah?" And so we'll be considering those things this morning ourselves, if I can get us queued up here to the right slide. Let's see here. A couple auto forwards. Okay, here we go. All right, so we've been studying over periodic nature the idea of figs and fig trees, fig leaves, the fruits of the fig tree, and we've discussed several lessons relative to that. The good life, shame and modesty, the good, the bad, the strange, the time and season, and then also fruitfulness or the lack thereof. Now, this morning what we're going to talk about is good, bad, and strange. Good, bad, and strange. So that's where we'll set our minds. So let me ask you this right off the top. The Lord God created the trees. Days of creation, he created them. What types of trees, types of categories of trees did he create? All of them? That would be the overarching category, yes. Okay. Trees good for eating. Trees good for food. Okay. How about another? For other practical values, that is true. You know, maybe you get into firewood and at least, you know, if you've got to grab a quick covering. but what was, scripturally speaking, what was another category? It's springtime. We'll all know it soon. Trees, good to look at. Beautiful to look at, right? So trees that we might look upon. And then there's two very special types of trees. You could call them categories, but they are actually two very special types of trees that were found there in the garden. And what were they? The tree, the knowledge of good and evil, and then the tree of life. Okay. So those are the categories. Now let me ask you this. Of the trees, which were Adam and Eve allowed to eat of? Okay. They were certainly allowed to eat from those trees which were good for food. Now, I wouldn't want to go eat a, you know, when the dogwoods are in bloom, I'm not sure I'd be go chewing on a dogwood flower. Right? But the trees that had fruit and were good for food. How about the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? Okay, no, no. Tree of life? Okay. All of the trees they were allowed to freely eat of except for the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. All right, so all we're doing is laying some groundwork here. So we have trees, and that's what we're going to focus on this morning, trees that are good for food. In other words, we take the fruit, we eat it, it becomes internalized, right? We pick it, we inspect it, we eat it, and it becomes internalized. A tree that was created by God was created with what? A purpose. If a tree is in the category which is good for food, then it's created with the purpose of doing what? Providing food, providing nourishment, right? So if I asked you then, What type of tree is this? You say, that's apple tree. Well, yeah, you know, the leaves are very similar for the six examples that we have up there, right? But you say, oh, you know, that's an apple tree. Okay. All right. Well, how about this one? Orange. Okay. Okay. It's oddly similar in leaves. You know, maybe it was another time of the year, perhaps, maybe in season, out of season. That's a good lesson in and of itself for another day. Here? Lemon. You got peaches. You have pears. You have cherries. How did you know? By their fruit, you know what kind of tree it is. By their fruit, you shall know. Right? And the same is true for the fig. Now, do we know if the lemon tree necessarily was in the Garden of Eden? Do we know if the fig tree was? Yeah, we know that one. We know that one. That's why we're sticking close to the fig tree, right? So let's study a little bit more about the fig tree. So we'll be coming back to Jeremiah 24 in just a moment. We'll be springboarding back and forth between Luke 6 and there. And so the point that we were just making is that every tree is known by its fruit. Now remember, before you get too far, we're still only talking about trees. But there will be a moment, and it might have already happened for you, but there will be a moment where we'll begin to make the metaphorical comparison. And this talk about trees and fruit, we'll start talking about people, even God's people, or those people who endeavor to be God's people, and some who pretend to be God's people. Now, before we go too much farther, there's one other little point we want to bring out, and that's this idea of producing after its kind. Producing after its kind. What does that mean? And very simply put, you're just not going to get an apple off a pear tree, right? And you might take that apple seed and plant it as much as you want to, and what are you going to get? You're going to get apples. It's going to produce after its kind as much as you might want a pear tree, right? But you're going to get apples. Fundamental principles. Fruit trees created with a purpose to feed, and with its seed within itself, will multiply after its kind. Still talking about trees. In Genesis 1, just so that we can scripturally pull those thoughts before we get too much farther, and the earth brought forth grass, an herb that yields seed according to its kind, and the tree that yields fruit, whose seed is in itself according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. So we're talking about God created, God approved thoughts, processes, creation. And so the evening and the morning were the third day. So let's nail it down. The bearing then of good fruit from those trees says what for you and me about that tree? Living up to its purpose, which is provide food and to multiply or produce after its kind, right? All right, that's a good metaphorical jumping off spot, all right? Produces after its kind and is good for nourishment. There are spiritual applications for you and I to make this morning about what we see, what we perceive, what we pick, what we inspect, what we eat, what we internalize for our nourishment, yea, even our spiritual nourishment. And then that is which is within ourselves will then yield fruit from there. But only after it's kind. Every tree is known by its fruit. Every tree is known by the fruit that it yields. There's good fruit, there's bad fruit, and there's strange fruit, like apples and pears. The Lord will use that principle and the prophet Jeremiah to bring this lesson to the Israelites in the days that they forgot their purpose. Good fruit. So if I said good fruit, what would you say? What constitutes good fruit? Ripe, yeah. Certainly arrives at its due season, but it's ripened, it's matured, it's ready, yes. Sure, has a good environment in which to thrive for the tree, yes. Yeah, it tastes good. It tastes like it's supposed to, right? What you'd expect it to, you know, to be, you know. So, yeah, if you take a bite of the apple, you want it to taste like an apple. If you want, you know, to squeeze a lemon and have some lemonade, you want it to be lemonade, right? It's what you expect. So good fruit is food, or is fruit that is good for food, air quote. It's palatable, right? It's palatable, which means you can digest it. Shouldn't give you a stomach ache. Shouldn't give you a headache. Shouldn't give you a spiritual ache, right? It's good for food. It's palatable. It provides healthy nourishment if eaten, if internalized. So on the flip side then, what's bad fruit? You give me the contrary or the negative to all those above, and you would be correct. Bad for food? Now notice, it's fruit. It could have been an apple from an apple tree. But it's rotten. It's not good for food. It's not palatable, and it's unhealthy if eaten. Now, strange fruit, that's an interesting category in and of itself, but the Lord uses it, and we will use it again this morning as he would have us do. A strange fruit, it's like a parent fruit, right? It's yielded after a different kind, right? And what I mean by that is that if you thought you were going to the apple tree, you know, to get a pear, and you got an apple, and you're thinking, well, somebody maybe in your childhood taught you that an apple was a pear and a pear was an apple, right? And that happens sometimes, right? If I take a wee one and I put an orange and a banana on the table every morning and I tell them that the banana is the orange and the orange is the banana, what are they going to think when they grow up? That's strange, and their parents are weird, right? So you're saying if someone was taught something and they had come to believe it, they had eaten it and internalized it, that's likely how they think. And that's also likely what they're going to teach their kids and anybody else's kids that come to the house. If eaten, could have serious or unexpected, you know, consequences. If you're out picking berries, you know what kind of berries you're picking. It can have really bad consequences. Really bad. That could give you a stomach ache, if not send you to the morgue. And what about no fruit, you might ask? Well, that is a good topic, but not for today. That's the last lesson of the series where Jesus curses the barren fig tree. We'll talk about that a couple of times from now. So let's go back to this study on Jeremiah. So here we are, in Jeremiah 24, right there at the threshold of the Babylonian captivity. Israel, God's people, you got the northern kingdom, you got the southern kingdom. They're divided. The northern kingdom's already been carried away. Assyria's already got them in pocket, right? And Babylon, the Babylonians are on the move. They go after Judah. They get Judah. God gives them Judah and Jerusalem. And they're carried away into captivity. Why? Because Israel, those that they planted in the promised land, had forgotten their purpose. and they, as a result, were losing the promised land. They were losing Jerusalem. They were losing the temple. The presence of God was leaving the temple, and they were losing God's favor. They were losing all around. See what happens when you forget your purpose, when you forsake your purpose? Now, the Israelites as a people, they have some serious fruit to bear, even to the fulfilling of the promises given unto Abraham. There are some serious fruit that needs to be brought forth, yielded. Again, topic for another day. But all of this is enough to make you cry. It's enough to make you and me cry. It's very sad. Lamentations. Book of Lamentations. In the Babylonian captivity, Jeremiah is a prophet of God, and he is prophesying in Jerusalem even as it falls. Even as Nebuchadnezzar is coming and grabbing the people and hauling them all off back to Babylon. Jeremiah is still back in Jerusalem, and he is prophesying. At the same time, we have Ezekiel. Ezekiel's been carried off. Where is he? He's actually back in Babylon. He's on the streets with the exiles, and he's prophesying too. Where do you think Daniel is? No, he's been hauled off to Babylon too. But he is in the court of the kings. He is in Nebuchadnezzar's court. You might say he's in the lion's den. And very specifically, will be in the lion's den when it becomes the Medo-Persian court, right? And Darius the Mede. This is all happening at the same time. But we're talking about Jeremiah now, in Jeremiah 24. So my question unto you this morning, as the Lord rendered unto Jeremiah in the day, the Lord said to Jeremiah, Jeremiah, what do you see? That's my question unto you this morning. What do you see? Good fruit and bad fruit. Good fruit and bad fruit. The basket of figs on one side, and another basket of figs on the other side. And Jeremiah says, yeah, I see them, good figs and bad figs, okay? Good figs and bad figs. And Jeremiah said, figs, the good figs, very good figs. And then there are the bad, the very bad, which cannot be eaten. They are so bad. Jeremiah was able to ascertain that just by looking. Right? Just by inspecting, right? But someone has gathered those figs. Someone has made a judgment and separated those figs. And at this point in time, who do you think this is? It wasn't Jeremiah. It was God. So God made a judgment. And he parted them left and right, good figs and bad figs. Yeah, and we're going to learn that. That's exactly right. That can happen and does. Mm-hmm. You betcha. You betcha. Now, my question to you, the part of Jeremiah I didn't read, what does each basket represent? Just let your eyes fall on the scriptures. Certainly. Evil, sure. They certainly should not be associated with, eaten, right? And the Lord God of Israel said, like these good figs, so I acknowledge those who are carried away captive from Judah, whom I have sent out of this place for their own good. The Lord said, I got them out of there to keep them safe. For their own good, and into the land of the Chaldeans, the Babylonians, for I will set my eyes on them for good. I see them, they're good, and we'll keep them good, right? And I will bring them back and I will build them and not pull them down, and I will plant them. Where are you going to get the seeds? From the good fruit. And that good fruit will produce after its kind, right? And not pluck them out. And then God said, then I will give them a heart to know me, that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. For they shall return to me with their whole heart. If you haven't made the spiritual metaphorical jump yet, you better do it now. Isn't that the basket, you and I? If we had put ourselves back in that day and time, would like to be in? It's something to consider, isn't it? It's something to meditate on, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely. How about the bad ones? Well, flip side, right? Surely thus saith the Lord, and as the bad figs which cannot be eaten, they are so bad, so will I give up Zedekiah, the king of Judah, his princes, and the residue of Jerusalem, all those that I haven't plucked up yet, right? Here's what's going to happen. Those who remain in the land, and those who, well, ran to Egypt, I will deliver them to trouble, into all the kingdoms of the earth for their harm, to be a reproach and a byword, a taunt and a curse, in all places where I shall drive them. And God said, and I will send the sword to and the famine, the pestilence among them, till they are consumed from the land that I gave to them and their fathers. My question is, which basket might you have been in? I can rephrase that question and say, do you suppose you might have forsaken your purpose as well? Or might you have retained or remembered your purpose and been placed in the good fruit basket? Springboarding to the New Testament, Luke chapter 6, verses 43 through 45, good, bad, and strange. For a good tree does not bear bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. For every tree is known by its fruit. For men do not gather figs from thorns, apples from pear trees, or pears from apple trees, figs from thorns, nor do they gather grapes from a bramble bush. That'd be strange. Good fruit, bad fruit, strange fruit. If you go out one day out into the meadow, out to go pick some grapes, and you think you're pulling grapes from the, let's say, the image here on the left-hand side, is that where you'd expect to find grapes? That old thorny bush? Little red berries looking a little rough? Maybe those berries do look nice. Maybe there was a time where they looked really polished red even, you know? But I don't think I want to be picking, harvesting my food from there, especially if I was going to go pluck some grapes. How about on the right-hand side? Anybody know what that is? It sure is pretty, but it's a thistle. Yeah. Old Sister Susie, remember her? Got one. All right. Sitting on a thistle. So a thistle is not a fruit. You know, it's got a pretty, you know, color to it. You know, almost looks the same color as old. It almost looks like a fig color. Looks real pretty. Got that little bulbous nature to it. Oh, and next thing you know, it's a weed. I'm just going to tell you right up front. It's a weed. Yeah, if you mess with it, it's not going to do right by you, right? You know, with the odor. And you certainly wouldn't want to eat it. And if left unchecked, it will take over the field. It'll do it. We'll do it quick. But what? I'm not going to get my grapes from here. I'm not going to get my figs from here. Because a good man, oh, now it's talking about you and me. A good person, out of the good treasure of his heart, brings forth good. You believe that? A good man out of the treasure, you know, the good treasure of his heart brings forth good. That's the fruit. But an evil person, out of the evil treasure of their heart, brings forth evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the abundance of the heart, the used carsman, the car salesman speaks. For out of the abundance of one's heart, they speak. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 15 through 20, it says, "Beware false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves." How do we know? How are we going to be able to spot them? "You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes?" Now, I have to ask you, I know it seems rhetorical, but it's really probably good for you and me both to say it out loud. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes? No. I don't care how pretty the little red berries are. They're not grapes. How about figs from thistles? No. 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 How about that thistle? Almost looks like you could just pluck it and eat it. I'd like to have a basket of them. No. You wouldn't as an individual, nor would a congregation, nor would the church. Uh-uh. So I've highlighted the other part of this scripture from Matthew 7. It says right up front, "Beware of false prophets." Well, like, who are you talking about? Matthew 7 tells us, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves." They look like that thistle. It looks pretty. It's kind of got the same color as a fig. Not a fig. Not a fig. Be careful. Be careful. Be on the lookout. Might happen. Who knows? Yeah. Or will happen. Put your guard up. Ravenous wolves in congregations. Does it happen? Yes. Happens all the time. Do we know it? Not if we're out there gathering baskets of thistles. Or we find out and it's too late. We got that spiritual stomach ache, or we're in the spiritual morgue. Be careful. Be on guard. Beware of false gods, false Christs, false prophets, false teachers, false brethren. They are anti-Christ. They are deliberate opposition. They are a basket of rotten figs. Do not eat from them. They are a basket of thistles. Do not eat from them. They may be silver-tongued. They may bring a good word. But I would remind you of how, air quote, Satan was able to use the scriptures when tempting Jesus. Pretty good at it, wasn't he? Jesus was better. And we have to follow his example and learn to be better. Your spiritual life may depend on it. Your kids' spiritual life may depend on it. My spiritual life may depend on it. Our collective spiritual lives may depend on it. Not that it might happen, but that at some point you can guarantee it will happen. How are we to know? How are we to know? Even so, every good fruit bears every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Again, therefore, by their fruits, you and I are to know them, which means we are to be inspecting, testing, proving. Don't take my word for this morning's lesson, please. Maybe I'm the silver-tongued, right? Maybe I'm a basket of thistles. Prove all things. Inspect all things. Test all things. Make sure that it's from the Holy Spirit, that it's from the Scriptures. Not just something Dave thought up this morning that would be cool to bring to you. We are to be fruit inspectors. Inspect all things. Hold fast to that which is good. Put them in a basket and hold on to them. And abstain from every form of evil. Test all things. Prove all things. Inspect all things. Whatever your favorite way of saying it is, but what it does not say is just take it for granted, you know, and just let, you know, whoever in the congregation say whatever and we'll consider it the gospel. Thus saith the Lord, takes care a lot of that. Having book, chapter, and verse references takes care a lot of that, although you need to make sure that you stay in context. Remember who the scripture's talking to. Don't just blindly open up the book of Job and start reading from his friends. Right? Book, chapter, and verse, thus saith the Lord. Scripture should be quoted like Jesus quoted Scripture. Not the way Satan did in Matthew chapter 4 in the wilderness when being tempted. What was Jesus' response to each of the temptations? For it is written. For it is written. Listen for those words. Listen for the thus saith the Lord's and for it is written. But make sure it's followed up with a book, chapter, verse. Otherwise, you're just getting my opinion. And what does my opinion add up to? I don't know. You don't know. Basket full of good figs? I hope so. It's my sincere intent to feed us all this morning with good figs. But you know what? Make sure you're the one eating it. Don't eat bad figs. Don't eat the thistles. I'm afraid that this is the way things are a lot these days relative to, you know, church efforts, if you will, congregational efforts, if you will. You know, folks heading to the church building, right, and they're going in, and there was a few hallelujahs, a few, you know, amens, and folks get to feeling real good, and nice things are said, and handshakes and hugs, they all abound, and we feel warm, and we feel fuzzy, right? We go in, right, and we don't even realize that the foundation of that congregation is not built on Jesus Christ. Well, it's not even built on shaky sand. You go right through the door and you fall right off the cliff. Don't be a lemming, right? Ensure that you inspect. You and I are fruit inspectors. Inspect the fruit that each of us are respectively yielding and inspect the fruit that the one sitting next to you is yielding, especially if they try, let's say, to sway or lead or teach the congregation, whether it's from the podium or from the pew. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. Do you believe it? It's not enough to say, Lord, Lord. Do you believe it? Yes, it's not enough. But he who does the will of my Father, that is in heaven. How do you know what the will of the Father is? That one you have to answer out loud. That's not rhetorical. How do you and I know what the will of the Father is? For it is written. For it is written, book, chapter, verse. Not for it is written in some really cool book I just got online or some really neat commentary that I'm reading. But because maybe those things steered you to the right scripture or verse here, and that's a good thing, right? That can be a good thing. But ultimately, the instructional point, the life-saving point, comes from here. And God provides. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Didn't we cast out demons in your name? And we did many wonders in your name? And this is what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7 about that. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. So you want me to inspect your works, eh? You want me to inspect your teachings and your Lord Lords, eh? Okay, I will separate them, good fruit, bad fruit, basket here, basket there. Guess what? You're not in the good basket. What do you suppose is done with all the bad figs? Where do they go? Using the spiritual metaphor and taking it all the way to the limit? Yeah, absolutely. What would, if I had a, you know, basket of bad figs on the counter back home, they'd be dumpster bound, right? Do not be spiritually dumpster bound. Do not be heading to that old trash fire, right? Because that's where the basket of bad figs, that's where the strange fruit, that's where they are all going. Lawlessness. But even if we, this is in Galatians, right? So Paul is talking, and he's talking about we, the apostles of Christ. If we, or an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel to you than that which we have preached to you, let him be accursed. Let him be put in the basket of bad figs and thrown out to the trash fire. Don't listen to him. Don't listen to her. As we have said and said, as we have said before, and now I say again. So that said, I've told you once. I'm going to tell you again, just to make sure you get it. Dave Dunce. I'm going to tell you once. I'm going to tell you again. Don't miss this. Okay. What don't you want me to miss? If anyone preaches any other gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. Don't you preach it, and don't you listen to it. That seems rude. Rude's got nothing to do with it. You got somebody playing out here on the street. Are you going to be worried about if they think you're rude because you've yanked them to the sidewalk? Life is at risk. Spiritual life is at risk. Don't. Yeah. Careful picking those berries. Yeah. Careful picking those berries. That's a fact. Yeah, and you don't have to take my word for it. Inspect it. Look it up. Matthew chapter 7. Thus saith the Lord. Very good. Thank you. So, in the few moments that we have left, I want to make sure that we choose good fruit over bad and always get your figs from fig trees. That's Dave's lesson today. Choose good fruit. Oh, if I led with that, you guys would have probably left. Choose good fruit over bad and always get your figs from fig trees, because every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. We don't want to be there. And in James chapter 3, verses 10 through 12, it talks a little bit more about strange fruit. It's another good example. I would point your attentions there. The questions are simply put, can a fig tree bear olives? It's another way of saying the same thing that we said. Yeah, well, and can a fig tree bear olives? No. Yeah. Can a grapevine bear figs? No. Okay, so we've gotten the lesson. But know, too, that when we talk about things that come out of our mouth, out out of the same mouth proceed blessings and cursings. And my brethren, these things ought not be so. So here we are. We're a tree. We're bearing fruit, right? But we can't bear two different types of fruit. Sometimes this reveals what kind of tree we are. Because out of the abundance and the treasures of our heart, it spouts out here, right? Does a spring send forth fresh water and bitter water, salt water, at the same time? No. If that water becomes salty, it's salt water. That's what you got. Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? That was the sentiment. Again, every tree is known by its fruit, so let's wrap it all up here. So the 1, 2, 3 lessons for today is to inspect all things. What do we mean then? Now we're taking it right to the spiritual lesson. What do we mean then by let's inspect all things? Compare it to the word. Take a look at it. You know, inspect, pray about it, meditate on it, right? If it's something that you haven't read or seen before, or maybe it was brought to you in a context you're unfamiliar with, prove it, test it, inspect it. False teachings abound, some from ignorance, while others from pure evil. With prayerful inspection, hold on tight to sound teachings. What do we mean by always get your figs from fig trees? What's the spiritual connection? Yeah, if you're going to do a thus saith the Lord, it's best to get it from the Bible. That's right. And to learn from those, perhaps, who are using the Bible in that way. Right? So this morning, you're not sitting at my feet, God forbid. You're sitting at Jesus' feet, and I'm just a conduit. Continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in the law of Christ, as that will surely lead to spiritual nourishment, and that's the yield unto salvation, even multiplying after its kind. That means your kids, your grandkids, and hopefully your neighbors, and others that come in contact with you who eat of your tree. We, the apostles of Christ, in this case John, are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. I don't want to hear it. That's what I know. That's what my daddy taught me. I don't want to hear it. However, having that right spirit, by this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Are we committed to the apostles' doctrine, to the law of Christ? It's really that simple. It's just like two baskets. It's like left and right, you know what I'm saying? Sheep and goats. Last lesson, as the bell rings, you and I, we are to bring forth good fruit and not bad. I think that's fairly self-explanatory. Faith comes by hearing. So does it matter what you and I hear? Yes. Does it matter what you and I, air quotes, spiritually eat and internalize? Yes. For our own sake and those whom we have sway or influence over, hearing by the word of God. Now, the works of the flesh are evident. When something's evident, what does that mean? If you're not lying to yourself, they're easily seen. But you know what? If you're not lying to yourself, so is the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit will connect into a subsequent lesson, but this is a good place for us to stop. What kind of fruit? If you're struggling with, what kind of, I got to bear good fruit. What does that look like? Fruit of the Spirit. That's good fruit. That's what you and I are to look like. And I'm not, for the sake of the quote and for your spiritual journey, I would request that you go read Galatians 6 to find out exactly, you know, if you're there at the supermarket line, you're kind of pinching the fruit, right? Is it good? Is it a bruise? You know, looking at it, you're inspecting it, go inspect Galatians 6 and put yourself on the scales with it. Because if the Lord were to come today, what basket would he put you in? What basket would he put me in? That's all I have. Thank you very much. Closing comments from anyone? Yes. Oh, did I? I got sick. Galatians 5. That works. Thank you for that. Prove all things, and that proves the point. Thank you for doing that, Jake. Very good.